welcome, welcome. My name is Michael Hellickson with Club Wealth Coaching and Consulting. Super excited. We're on Facebook Live, YouTube Live. We're on, I don't know, Google Hangouts. We're all over the place right now. We've got awesome folks on the call today. So excited to have, of course, my co-host. We've got Brian Curtis of Curtis Realty Group over in Bentonville, Arkansas. Brian is one of our coaches at Club Wealth. Brian, currently is doing about 35 to 40 transactions a month in his business, so he's killing it. Also, we've got Mr. Mike Bjorkman over in Santa Clarita, California. He's also one of our Club Wealth faculty members. Mike is also killing it. He does about $1.5 million per year over there in Santa Clarita. In addition to that, he's also out of production on his team, so essentially his team kind of runs itself. Tammy runs that. And Mike is running his other three businesses. He's got four brokerages. He's got a property management company with about 750 doors. And he's also got his escrow company that does very, very, very well. And so we're excited to have him as well. And today's special guest, by the way, is Mr. Wear That Kilt with Honor himself, Mr. Euan Graham over in Denver, Colorado. Check it out. There's Euan Graham right there. And by the way, don't call him Irish just because he wears a kilt. Don't be thinking he's Irish. He's not. He's Scottish, and there's a difference. I figured that out. So it's important to remember that. So Euan Graham, welcome to Club Wealth TV, man. We're super excited to have you. So tell us a little bit about you and about some of the stuff that's going on in your world.
So I'm honored to be on this episode of Club Wealth TV. Michael, thanks for having me on. I'm Euan Graham. I'm with a company called Madison & Company Properties. I have a small team there currently building that out. We're in Denver, Colorado. And just for you, Michael, I went that extra mile this morning and decided to wear...
Yeah, baby!
I love it.
That is freaking awesome.
Better represent the homeland whenever I can. So
I love it.
If you want to buy real estate in Denver, Michael, I know a good guy that can help you, and he will wear a kilt to the closing. I can guarantee that. Okay.
Dude, that is awesome. You know, and it's funny because we were talking about, you know, why does Euan Graham wear a kilt, and what does he know that we don't, right? I mean, obviously, there's something magical about the kilt, and we're not talking about that video Tara posted in this thread earlier, but yeah, man, that's awesome. I love it. And you know, here's one of the things that I think is actually, in all seriousness, with the whole kilt thing, it's a brand, man. Like people, when they think of you, they think of, you know, Euan. He's the guy. He's the Scottish guy. He wears a kilt. He's got the sexy accent. He's like the guy, and it's part of your brand, and that's a good thing. So before I forget, before we get too far into this, I know we got a lot of people watching right now. What I want you guys to do is type your questions for Euan into the comments box here in this live video, either on the Club Wealth. The Michael Hellickson's Club Wealth Real Estate page, or in the Club Wealth Real Estate Agent Mastermind group. We're going to be monitoring both of those feeds during the call today to make sure that you guys each get your questions answered. So here's what I want to do. I want to turn it right over to Mike and Brian, and I want you guys to start hammering Euan with questions, and let's figure out, let's really dig into his business, find out what he's doing well and what for us.
We're having a little audio problems. Euan, can you hear me, buddy?
Yeah.
We got you.
Light and clear.
Yes.
All right, awesome. So first of all, I wanted to say in the last 6 months or so since I met you at the BSM, you've gained my respect tremendously, and I have watched you and I follow you, and I'm impressed with two different things. Number one is your consistency with video on Facebook. I'd love to know how that's working, because there's times us agents, we want to go live, we want to do these videos, we just don't have the oomph in us, or maybe we don't know if our content's good enough, so I'd like to hear about that. I guess we could start with that. How's that working for you?
Well, first of all, it helps that nobody really can understand what I'm saying, so they're just watching me with pictures. So I don't have to worry about, you know, talking eloquently or saying, you know, great content. I'm just there on the screen with a funny accent. But I'll tell you what, I think, so I've been doing this for just a little over 6 years, and obviously I'm not from here, but you know, I count my blessings every morning to be in the United States of America, and there's no other place I would want to be. You know, I'm so blessed to be here. So I want to make that clear that that's one of the things that definitely helps me. It's the idea out there, maybe that other people don't, and just, you know, feeling lucky and privileged to have the opportunity. So I always, you know, frame anything by saying that, because that's what gets me up in the morning. That's what, you know, makes me go out there and hustle. And so, you know, thank you, America, for everything I have, because I owe you everything.
I love the attitude of gratitude, man. That's so awesome.
But so the video for me is, if you watch what I do, I've done some, most of the videos that I've done, I do like a weekly rant video, a hump day rant, where it's kind of like a more a motivational thing of, you know, get off your butts and make life happen for you. So I'm never really, really talking specifically about real estate. I'm not asking for business. I'm not telling you that, you know, I'm the guy that you need to use when you're selling or buying real estate, or here's the latest, you know, market stats in Denver. Or it's not about that. I'm trying to give value. You know, jab, right hook, as Gary Vee says. Without ever asking for the business, but making sure that there's a consistency behind it. There's a message, and people actually want to watch my videos, and it just grows from that. You know, we're getting about 2,000 views now on a Wednesday little hump day rant that I do for 3 minutes. So it's just that consistency and being fearless. And like that's my approach to life. Be fearless in everything you do, because the worst thing that can happen is somebody says no or it doesn't work out, but you got to go for it, right? And I think to try things. And I think, you know, the big thing for me, Mike, is one of our core values in our group is we're zigging while everybody else is zagging. So we want to be doing, you know, everything. Agents know they should be doing video, but they're not doing it, right?
Right.
So we're going to get out ahead of that. We're going to take advantage of, try and be the ones that are doing everything first. And set a standard for it. So
absolutely. One of the things I wanted to point out to the audience, and you know, we're coaching people all the time, and not to say that direct mail doesn't work, but for instance, I'll send out 8.5 by 11 postcards, and I'll send out 1,000 of them at 75¢ a piece. So that could be $750 for 1,000 views, goes in the trash. You're getting 2,000 views, right? So in essence, that's $1,500 worth of mailing that you get, but you're actually getting them to see your face, which is almost as good as a handshake. They get to see you're a genuine guy. I mean, the ROI is ridiculous. So I guess the follow-up question would that be, are you noticing people are talking about it? Are they calling you? Are your friends starting to say, hey, we're starting to love the videos? Are you really seeing some traction? Because I think that's what our viewers want to hear. Yes, it's working. I mean, everybody could say we're doing video, but can you honestly say, man, I'm gaining traction and it's working?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of my friends, clients that are looking forward to that Wednesday episode. They know something's coming. They watch it. One of my agents and I, Eli, we do a kind of a Monday video as well, where we do a Facebook Live. And you know, it's just, I think, Mike, the big thing is the consistency, and then people get used to seeing it. If they like the content, they start watching it, they start sharing the content, and it just and it grows organically from there. So without a doubt, I've had people reach out to me, say, you know, they're looking forward to the Wednesday, the rant. And it's, I think, through their social media as well, it's gaining traction there. And I think the big thing is people want to see you're a real person. If you're sending, you know, nothing wrong with doing mailers, but if you're sending mailers out or you're sending marketing info out, they don't really know who you are. And with, you know, people live on these. Like, this is where everything is. And if you're not doing it and you're scared to do it, then you're missing out on a huge opportunity. So I think, you know, we've not been doing it a long time, but I think with the amount of time we've been doing it, we do see traction. And I just think it's the compound effect. It's the consistency. It's the message. And it just, you know, I'm a positive guy, so I show that on camera. I show my passion and my enthusiasm, and that's why people want to work with me, because yeah, anybody can help them buy a home, but they want to work with somebody that is passionate and has a positive outlook in life and really wants to help them. So I try and be genuine and authentic to who I am and everything I do.
Well, and one of the things I really like about what you're saying, Euan, is first of all, people have, and I tell people this all the time, people have to know, like, and trust you in order to do business with you. And what you're doing is you're showing them not only that you're professionally competent, but that you personally care when they get that backstage pass to kind of your life, right? They got to really get to know who you really are. And to your point, when they see that passion, when they see that you're a happy guy and that you're friendly, that you're more approachable that way. Whereas when people don't know who you are, they don't feel, give me an example. I'll bet all the time when you're working with a new client, I'll bet it's frequent that they'll say, man, I feel like I already know you because I've seen you on your videos and I see you online and I feel like I kind of already know who you are. I've kind of been cyber stalking you. You ever get people talking about that?
Well, that's the thing. It's if somebody's referred to me from a past client or a family member or a friend, they're going to instantly go on Facebook and look me up and they're going to look who this guy is. And if there's nothing there, there's nothing about who I am, what I do, what I stand for, that isn't a good representation of who you are. So I think, you know, the big thing is we can all sit down and list in appointments and show them our stats and show them how wonderful we are and how well we sell properties, but can we really separate ourselves? And, you know, I like to think about the book Mr. Smooze, if you've ever read that book. It's like being that guy, like going above and beyond and separating yourselves at all costs. Because I think the big thing is, as you said, people want to work with people they like, but they want to work with people that they're getting value from and they're getting, you know, they're getting that. And that's just, you know, who I am. It's not like I fake it. It's just to help. And that's where my passion is. And I think, you know, right across the board and whatever I do, whether it be a client event or the videos or just working directly with the consumer, they get a great sense of that.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Brian. Hey, Euan, this is Brian. Good to hear from you. I got to know you at BSM as well. It's good to see
you.
Hey, so here's my question for you along this line. I love the video stuff, and I know that there are so many people out there right now who are scared to death of video. And, you know, we talk about actually doing video text on our team, and I got people who are scared to be on their phone on a video they can delete, and they're afraid to do that. So, I applaud you. The second thing, here's a question for you, and I hope that, you know, you can kind of help people understand how simple and easy this actually is. I think one of the big barriers of entry to doing video is they don't know what to say. So maybe where can you share some of your general content, where you're getting it from, and, you know, who you are? Because if you said to me, Brian, make a video right now, well, I can talk and talk and talk. People know that about me. So that's not a big deal for me, but that's not true for everybody. So if you don't mind, share what are some of the things that you're sharing, some of the things that have been really successful for you.
Well, I think for me, it's all about, I try and fill my life with, you know, positivity. I read a lot, I listen to a lot of podcasts, and it's like feeding my brain with, you know, energy and things that are stretching. Like, we're always like trying to achieve more and more. And for me, like, the things that I always talk about are, you know, I did one last week or 2 weeks ago that I said, life is not a dress rehearsal. My dad used to say this to me all the time. You don't get another shot at life. You don't get to wake up and rewind the clock 20 years and replay it. So it's like, people out there are always looking for something, like a lift up. And I just, that's the kind of motivation and passion that I have for that, and talking about those types of things and talking about, you know, what you put out there in the world comes back to you. So if you're full of negativity and you're full of, you know, life owes me something, that's what you're going to get back. But if you put out that, you know, we're lucky, we're blessed to be here, we've got all the opportunity in the world, there's people out there to help us, mentor us. Like, I'm lucky enough to be mentored by Michael. Like, that's incredible. And he's in my life. So do you think that my life sucks right now? No.
Absolutely not.
And it's just about getting that, it's about getting that message out. So, you know, that's kind of where I come from. I think you have to, Brian, the big thing, if you want to do anything on video, make the content good so that people will watch it, but don't overthink it. And be genuine to who you are. Because if you try and talk about something or do something that has got nothing, you don't have a handle for, or you can't talk to, then it's not going to work out, and you're going to get 5 views and you're going to give up, because, you know, we all like to see how many likes we get on our Instagram posts and our how many views on video, and you know, it's crazy how the world works now. But be authentic to who you are, who your sphere, your clients know you as. So, you know, that would be my big tip.
That's okay, awesome.
So I want to jump in on that because this is a big deal. Like what we're talking about here. And by the way, for those of you that are watching this live right now, or even if you're not watching it live, everybody that comments on this post today, you're going to get an entry into our Hawaiian vacation giveaway contest. And Elgin Walker, I see that you're watching it right now. Shout out to Elgin Walker, who freaking won the trip. Well, technically his wife won it last year, but guess who gets to go with him? Elgin gets to take advantage of that. So congratulations on that. That being said, we'd love to see one of you guys win it this year. So put your comments in the screen right now. And for every comment we get on this post, you got each one of you is going to get an entry into the Hawaiian vacation giveaway drawing. What I wanted to key in on here that Euan was just saying is how, you know, some people get hung up on what do I do on video? You know, what do I say? How do I do this? And so here's some rules. And he mentioned this that I think are very important on how to do video easily and effectively. Number one is stay positive. Nothing negative ever, right? You're never tired. You're never sick. And it's the Facebook you, right? So Mike and I were joking about that earlier. It's like, you know, that you've got the real you and then there's the Facebook you. The Facebook you, nothing's ever wrong, right? Well, that's okay. So that nobody wants to hear your negativity. Nobody wants to hear that you're sick or that you're having a bad day or whatever. The next thing is make it fun, right? Have fun with it. Don't overthink it. And that was another piece is don't overthink what you're doing. And always have good quality content. But most importantly, Euan, one of the things that I heard you say that I really, really believe is that you have to be authentic to who you are. And and here's some reasons for that. If you are like, if I go out there and I portray that I'm the party guy, right? I'm attracting the wrong people to me. Those, you know, because once they get to know me, they're going to find out that I'm not the party guy and they're not going to want to be around me or they're not going to want to do business with me because that's just not really who I am. You know, likewise, like if Mike Bjorkman, right? If you're attracting people, you know, how often do you wear a tie? Careful. I mean, really, right? Like you're not the tie guy. What's that? No, careful. Yeah, exactly. But think about that. You know, you want to be congruent with who you really are, and you want to attract the people that are not only going to be attracted to you in the beginning, but people who are going to want to be a part of your world long term. Because those are the people that are going to really get to know, like, and trust you, and those are the people that are going to refer you. And the type of people they're going to refer you are probably people that are a lot like them, which now, by extension, makes them a lot like you because you attracted the right people into your life. Video is a very, very powerful way to do that. Guys, take it away. I see Mike and Brian are chomping.
Yeah, I am. I want to hear, and don't let us forget about this. I know we got plenty of time. I want to hear you and about how you're building your team. But first, since we're on this human thing, we're on your personality, be genuine to yourself. Now, I don't get a lot of handwritten cards. We talk about it in Club Wealth all the time, handwritten cards. After BSM, you wrote me a really nice handwritten card. There's probably 50 of my friends in Denver. You, my friend, are getting the referrals because you took the time to say something, made me feel good, and it was amazing. But what I'd like to know, and I'd love an honest answer, is that is a very smart way of getting business. Referrals, you know, you call me and you're in jail. I'm definitely going to help you out now. But I want to ask you a question.
Wait, hold on. You're probably right there.
but I guess what my question is I want to know, I mean, that's a very powerful networking business technique. Now, how many of those cards did you write after BSM? And you can be honest, it doesn't hurt my feelings because at least I got one, but was it 5, 10, 20, 50? And how does that work for you? And I assume you do that all the time.
Bjorkman, you were the only one that got one because you're so special.
See how good he is?
He sent a bunch of people.
If you're going to send me all the referrals, I'll just tell you you're the only one that got one.
All right, let's talk about it.
So I sent probably about 10 cards out to people that I'd really connected with. Because, you know, I think I'm trying to be authentic. I could have sent 30 cards out maybe to people that I just had a very, very brief conversation, but there was no connection there with. Send it to the 8 to 10 people that I had deep connections with and that I had huge respect for. Believe it or not, Mike, I respect you immensely, okay?
Thanks, so, buddy.
The thing is, again, taking it back to when I first started in real estate, I'd only been in the country for about 18 months, so I didn't know any. I really had a really small sphere, so I was very naive when I first started. I didn't understand about real estate. Most people have a scarcity mindset. There's over 25,000 agents just in Denver alone, the metro area. I didn't have any idea about that agents do 3 to 4 deals a year on average. So I was very naive, but I was lucky enough to do a coaching conference for 3 days in my first year with Larry Kendall, who's up in Fort Collins, the Ninja Selling, and he talked about setting a foundation, providing a level of service to your clients. And one of the big things was handwritten notes. Like, I didn't know anything about the whole handwritten note deal. And he just said, think about how when you receive a handwritten note in the mail, like how you feel. And because that's gone by the wayside, nobody wants to write a handwritten note. My mom still shops for her Christmas and birthday cards a year in advance. She's obsessed with cards. But it's like, you know, how does that make you feel? And when somebody writes a handwritten note and you get it and you read it, it makes you feel great because somebody's gone and taken the time to sit down and write some words. So I thought about that and I thought, well, why am I not doing that? And obviously from there on in, it's the consistency thing again. It's making sure that you're doing it on a consistent level, but actually sending them to people with a genuine level that when you're writing the card, it actually means something, and you're making that person feel good, and it makes you stand out, I think, because nobody's willing to do that in this day and age.
Dude,
other people are not willing to do.
Great answer. Great answer.
I want to jump in on this because I think you and I think you are absolutely correct on that. I just want to show you guys a little bit of what I've got in my hand here. Check this out. Handwritten personal note from someone. Another one. Here's one from Giovanni Santa Anna. I've got Euan Graham's. I've got several from Euan Graham. I've got then send out cards, right? Check out Gail Zenitech, right? She sends out these send out cards, right? And send out cards is great. I prefer the personal handwritten note. But as a backup to that, if you absolutely don't have time to do the handwritten one, then send out cards is a great way to go.
Just go quickly, Michael. The other thing that I've done from a long time ago is I exploit my children, and they're not working in the basement or anything like that. They're on the front of my cards, my personal cards, and I take my wife makes these cards. She sends pictures away, and they come in the mail. And it's always my two kids or a family picture on the front, and that's who I am. I'm trying to send a card. It's not my logo on it with Graham Group, and I'll never forget. I sent a card to clients that I met years ago when I first met them, and I sent them a handwritten card. And they responded immediately when they got it and said, we have never received a card like this. It is completely personalized and authentic to who you are. Like, bravo for doing this. Keep it up and keep sending these cards out, because nobody does that. And it was just, you know, yeah, we can all write cards, but are they authentic? Are they genuine? Are they who you are? And, you know, if you get a card from me, it's always got my kids on the front.
I love it. Seriously, you know, people underestimate the value of it. I mean, every day, I'll give you an example. George Bush Sr., right? He spent literally his entire career. People asked him, they said, what's the secret to your success? Why is it that you've had so much success in everything you've done? And one of the things that he credits is he says, look, no matter what, I write 10 personal handwritten notes every single day. And I mean, he would write them to everybody. You know, if somebody was setting up for a rally that he was doing, he would write it up to, you know, write a personal note to the guy that was setting chairs up for that rally, or he would, you know, on up to the heads of states. You know, I mean, look at it. Here's mine for today. I've got to fill out all these ones today. You know, it is really, really important, and it shows people that you're caring about, that you care about them. Here's the system for it. I want to give you guys a really easy system for personal notes. 3 to 5 lines, blue ink, broad tip pen if you've got one. Upper right-hand corner, I want you to put the day, date, time, and location that you were at when you wrote the personal note. And then always end with a unique close. Never say sincerely or respectfully. Make it unique to you, to Ewan's point. Make it authentic to you. And hey, I'm all about exploiting my children. Absolutely. Dude, that's why I brought you into this world, so I would have a kid to exploit. I mean, okay, maybe not quite. But seriously, you need to you know, make sure people understand that. Look, I'm a family guy. If you don't like your kids, then don't put them on the postcard. But if you like your kids, put them on there.
So, and the puppies. Anyway, don't forget stuff. The puppies, too.
Kirkman's great at exploiting his dog. Holy cow. Talk to us about that. And not only you, but what about Tim Ray? Look at what the success that Tim Ray is having with little Bill.
Bill's got his own Facebook
page. Talk about that, Mike.
Yeah, well, Bill was unknown a few months ago, and Tim took him wine tasting for his birthday up in San Ynez, and we had a long talk about exploiting your children and dogs. And sure enough, Bill, within just a matter of, I'd say, 90 days, is probably the most popular dog in our real estate industry, to where he did need his own fan page. And he takes Bill everywhere, and his clients and his sphere of influence are actually calling and asking if Bill could come with them on his listing appointments. I mean, Bill has really changed. It made him look like a good guy. You know, like I used to say, you know, when I was younger in the business, it was hard to have somebody know, like, or trust me, or they trusted me, but they sure didn't like or know me. And then when I started exploiting my family and my animals, they go, you know, he's not such a bad guy. You know, they get to know me a little bit. He does have this. And then sure enough, you know, they started to like what I was doing for the community and bringing the family and doing those things. So I think that's important. And I think that it goes right along with the handwritten cards and doing all the things that it takes to be human, especially in Euan's stage of his career. He's at that tipping point now where he's going to do 50, 60 deals or more this year. And pretty soon he's going to have the chance to either get cocky, too busy to care, or perception will hurt him a little bit, and he's going to have to do some damage control, and he's going to have to do some, you know, PR throughout the community to calm down what the haters say. So all these things that we're talking about are real, and if we don't do them, we could really damage our business and slow down the growth. So
I would say, Mike, going in on that, I think, whoever, you know, for the audience that's listening, we probably have a widespread audience from people that are in big teams and doing, you know, hundreds of transactions a year, and people that are maybe just starting out. And I think my big thing for people that are just starting out, or maybe needing that kickstart again in their career, it's about, I firmly believe this, and I obviously, with the naivety I had when I first started, but my mindset was always about abundance. There's enough to go around for everybody. And as we know in real estate, everybody's looking for that. They're looking for the magic bullet that they just need to turn on, and it's suddenly going to change their life. Well, we know it's not out there. It's like anything you do, you have to work at it. But, you know, I went out my first year lucky enough to do 36 transactions my first year. And I just thought that was average, right? And then I found out it wasn't. You know, I didn't know. I thought I was just an average realtor doing 36 deals a year. Mm-hmm. What I found out was that I wasn't buying leads. I wasn't even knocking doors. I was just building relationships, and I was writing notes, and I was hustling. Yes, I was working 7 days a week, 85, 90 hours a week, and I never saw my family, but I had to do that. Like, it's a learning curve. If you have to do these things. Like, anybody that joins my team, I say, look, for the first 2 years in the business, when you start, you just gotta give up on life and just go to work for that. Because you have to establish yourself. You can't, have the work-life balance in year one. I just don't believe that. Because if you're a solo agent out there, so the big thing I think is, that have that abundancy mindset, that to whatever you're doing, there's enough to go around. There's enough transactions to go around, and you can very easily separate yourself. I'll never forget my first month in real estate. I would call these agents and leave messages on their listings, and it would be like crickets. I wouldn't hear a thing. I'm like, geez, if I can just pick up the phone and take a call or return an email or return a voicemail, I've already separated myself in my first month from 80% of the other agents out there. And I think that's that, a basic simple thing of answering email and answering the phone can separate yourself in this business. So, like, just think about that. Think about the abundancy, and think about there's enough to go around. And if you and be consistent with it, you'll have success.
Euan, that's really awesome. And I've heard you say abundance probably 15 times. If anyone doesn't take that we should be abundant away from this phone call, then, or this broadcast, I think they probably missed out. So I heard you say something else, and it's kind of a Yogi Berra quote. The harder I work, the luckier I get. And I'm sure we've all heard that quote. Here's my question for you. What does your morning look like? So, what do you, when you get up in the morning, what are you doing? What does your day look like so you can quote unquote get lucky?
Well, I think it does. Like, for me, it starts off, it does start off from when my alarm goes off at 4:15 a.m. So I'm up really early. But my mindset is I'm up when everybody else is still sleeping. And it's just something that I'm ahead of the game. And I do have a morning routine where, I get up, I make some coffee, I need some caffeine, but I do, I give gratitude. I write down what I'm grateful for. I visualize what I'm trying to achieve and what it feels like when I'm going to achieve these goals of mine. And then I'll read something. So, I'm always reading, when I can in the morning or at night. Basically, I'm focusing on the day ahead. I'm getting that day aligned with what I need to be doing so that there's no surprises around the corner. So I know what my day is going to look like. And then my exercise every morning, I feel that is a huge help for me. So by 7 o'clock in the morning, I've done all these things. I've got my day ready and I'm headed to the office. So, I'm not going to preach to everybody that they should be getting up early in the morning and all that kind of stuff. But I think it's about what you do when you're awake. It doesn't really matter. Whatever time you get up, it's about what you do during those hours. If you're unproductive and you're sitting on Facebook and just, scrolling through cat pictures or cat videos, then you're not going to sell a lot of real estate, right? And you got to attack your day with intent.
I don't know about that, Euan. I mean, seriously, let's call it what it is. I know Bjorkman loves his cat videos, and he still sells a lot of real estate. So,
Well, and let's stop right there, because that was the amazing segue into the team. So the fact that I can watch cat videos all day, how are you building your team? You and I, you know, one of the things about being in a club wealth coaching atmosphere is we're always talking about building teams, expansion teams, and you are definitely one of the agents that want to go to the next level. So tell us how the coaching and your mindset, and what are you doing to build this team? What CRMs are you using? Whatever you're comfortable with sharing, please share it with us, because there's a lot of great agents watching this, and I'd love to help them out.
Of course, I'm transparent. I'll tell, you know, I always tell people I'm maybe too transparent, and I tell, you know, people everything about me, but that's just who I am. I like to be. You know, I like for people to know who I am. And so for what happened with me, Mike, is that I got to about the third year in my business, and I'll never forget it. I hit a breaking point. I was still a solo agent. There was three of us in my office. We were sharing an assistant. So we kind of had access to an assistant to help us with some paperwork. And I had 18 transactions going myself at the one time. I had 18 deals going, I had 18 under contract. And I was juggling way too many balls, and I was beginning to drop balls. I was beginning to burn out because it was just 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And I kind of hit a cracking point, and I said, enough's enough. I need to, if I'm going to be able to have a career in real estate, have longevity here, and build a legacy for my family through real estate, then I have to make some drastic changes. So I hired my first full-time assistant, and that was the first thing that I did. She didn't last too long. Maybe I'm a little tough to work for. but over the last 3 years, I've really built, obviously having a full-time assistant at all times, and then about 18 months ago, I brought on a buyer's agent. And then from there, I went through a few buyer's agents. Because I think, honestly, hiring, until you kind of gain a knack for it, is definitely the hardest thing. Especially when you're doing it without club wealth, for example. But I definitely think that it's very tough to hire people, because you can do a lot of due diligence, but you're always taking a risk, but you have to minimize that risk. So I'll never forget when Michael and I were doing one of our first coaching calls, I said, I need to get a new assistant. We have a card for that. And I was like, what? We have a card for that? And he said, yeah, we have a Trello card. Just follow exactly step by step. Do not question me. I've hired hundreds and thousands of people. This is how you do it. So that was beautiful. Like, you know, and we did that, and we had great success. So my team, as of about a month ago, was myself, Nicole, my full-time assistant, team manager, and then we had two buyer's agents. One left to pursue real estate with another company, and so I've got Eli and myself. Eli does all works with all the buyers, and I take all the listings. But to Michael, he's hammering me to get more buyers agents, which we're looking to do right now. And the CRM that we use, we've started to use Sync Commissions Inc. for that, and we have everything in there, and we manage it through that platform because we utilize Commissions Inc.
So Tara, actually, since you're bringing up Commissions Inc., Tara, why don't you go ahead and put our discount link into the comments of the thread here in the Club Wealth group, so that we can shout out to those guys. Anybody that wants to explore that can take a look at it and get our discount. Now, Euan, we've got a couple of questions for you. One of the questions is from Eddie Zapian, who's asking, how do you approach letting someone go? It's a great question, Eddie. Thank you for that question.
I think I've been quite fortunate in that they've let themselves go before I've had to let them go. I think it gets to that. I feel if you know somebody's not right fit, it obviously gets to that point where you're going to have to discussion, draw a line in the sand, and they either cross the line and move forward with you, or they stay on that side of the line and they basically self-select. Like, I'll give you an example. You know, last buyer's agent we had, we had a discussion. It was like, I said, look, I'm a fair person. I want to help, but there's a line in the sand. And if you can't cross that, there's no room for you on the team. You just make it very clear. And then she decided to pursue real estate with another company. So it was kind of a self-selection. So I think these things work themselves out, but you have to be up front and forthright when you're hiring people and kind of firing people. You know, you can't just be Mr. Nice Guy and have everybody dragging along with you, because if they're not a right fit, they're going to drag your business down and they're going to drag you down. And that's certainly not what I'm all about. I'm all about people. That's all pulling. I say we're on that ship and we're all pulling the ship in the same direction. Nobody on the team is pulling in the opposite direction. You've got to have a clear vision, and you've got to have a clear bought into that vision. Because if you don't, you're not going to have that success and you're not going to see the results. And when you don't see the success and the results, things start to implode. So I think you have to be very clear on that.
Yeah. Good stuff. Mike, Brian?
You have anything?
All right, let me jump in on this real quick since you guys aren't ready to. So listen, first and foremost, team culture matters. And I hear a lot of comments here about, you know, Brian, you made the comment, you know, that when you have the right team culture, people self-select themselves in or out of your team. It also helps from a recruiting standpoint. When you have that right culture on your team, people are attracted to your team. They want to be on your team. And guys, with whether you're the Lone Ranger or you're planning on building a team, you either need to be on a team or you need to build a team long-term if you're going to be really successful in this business. It's getting harder and harder and harder to be the Lone Ranger in this business. And that's why, to Mike's point, you know, we talk a lot about building teams and even expansion teams into other market with Club Wealth. Why? Because it's such a big deal, and that's where the industry is headed. And I'll tell you that it really is going to come down to culture. The teams that have and are able to build, develop, and maintain the best culture are going to be the ones that have the most people wanting to be on their team. They're going to have the most success. They're going to be the most profitable. And they're going to have the least amount of drama. And speaking of drama, if you have drama on your team, you need to cut it out like the cancer it is. We do not do drama in any way, shape, or form. We don't have time for it. Any kind of drama, all it will do is rip your team apart. So be very, very careful about allowing that to sneak into your business. So great stuff. I really appreciate that. What are you doing, Euan, for recruiting right now? Are you what kind of activities are you doing to get people onto your team?
Well, what we're doing, and this is something through your guidance as well, Michael, and something that we had tried previously. We're like reaching out to agents that are doing a certain number of transactions. About 6 to 15 transactions a year in the Denver metro area. And we're reaching out to them. We're emailing them directly. We're looking to just set up a coffee appointment with them. And through what we were talking about on our last call about that, wanting to network with them, wanting to see if we can provide any value to them so that they see what the potential is. Because I can tell you right now, I would have given my right arm for a spot on my team. I'm not getting big headed here, but just when I first started.
I told you it was coming, Euan. I told you it was coming.
You can read my mind.
Hey, Euan, let me ask you this. So this is one of the things that I hear all the time from different people. And, you know, why should I be on a team? You know, Michael's makes a point all the time, either start a team or be on a team. So if I interviewed with you, what would you tell me that, why should I be on your team?
First, ask you why you would not want to be on my team, Brian, because I'm sure there's a spot for you.
I would love to be on your team. I'm coming to Denver in a couple of years, and you're the first person I'm calling.
I'll buy you a kilt and everything. You can learn to talk with a Scottish accent, and the sky's the limit. I would just say, if you're a new agent, What is your biggest obstacle?
Me as a new agent, I don't know what to do. I've got nobody to talk to, and I probably don't know what to say to them if I did.
Lead generation, right?
Absolutely.
So without a doubt, when you first start or when you're an agent that is maybe only doing a handful of transactions a year, you don't know how to lead generate. And that's a skill. But if you can get on with somebody that has a proven business and lead generation tools behind them, and they're going to provide these opportunities for you, then, you know, it would be difficult to turn down that opportunity. Because what I always say to people is, look, when it comes to being on a team, yes, you do have splits, and everybody's splits are different, but, you know, a piece of something rather than a piece of nothing. And, you know, I've shown many agents how, you know, they're going to make six figures with me in their first year in real estate, and that's still with a split
back to the team. So, you know, I think the thing is,
there you need the lead generation entering. That's a big part of what I do on my team is help mentor, because I've made every mistake in the book. I've not seen it all and done it all yet, by no means, but there's a lot of things that I say, look, I got to here in 2 years, I can get you there in 6 to 12 months. I can fast track your business and fast track you as an agent and introduce you to a tremendous number of opportunities.
I love it.
Sold yet, Brian?
Yeah, I'm in. I'm telling you, in a couple of years, I'm moving to Denver.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You know, we just launched a team this week for our HomeSmart brokerage. And here's what I found out. And I've been talking to a lot of agents. And I asked them, I say, are you one of those people that say, if I only had that lead, I know I could work with them. I know I can close them. And a lot of people are saying yes, because that is true. Lead gen is a very hard thing. And I said, do you want to be trained? Do you want to be held accountable? Do you want that team atmosphere and camaraderie and culture? And it's amazing to me how many people say, yes, that's what I'm craving every day. I wake up and I just do nothing, and I think I know what to do, but I don't. I just want to be led. I want to be part of something big. I want to be making good money, but yet being held accountable. It's amazing. So it's hard for us as drivers to say, how in the heck could you want to be part of that? We want to create that culture for people, but it's amazing to me that how many people are really out there. So when you start using that sort of language saying, do you want to be held accountable? People saying yes. I'm like, okay, cool. Do you want to be coached? Yes. Do you want to be handed leads? Yes. And you're like, well, then you should be on my team. Let's make this happen. And I think the more we get experienced as agents and building these teams, we find that out. We just say, we would love to guide you through that process and make sure you're very successful. And when they see you're genuine, you really care about them and you care about the team, I think that makes all the difference in the world. And I think you, and with your attitude of gratitude, and you come from a place of abundance and not scarcity, I think they can see that, and that's a breath of fresh air for them. So I think in the future, you know, you better bump up your ad spend quite a bit, because you're going to have a hell of a ride, buddy.
I love it. And Mike, I like what you just said about, you know, people want to be a part of something bigger than themselves, right? They want that camaraderie, they want that team atmosphere, and that's a big deal, and that's something that people underestimate the value of. So definitely, you guys, when you're working to build your teams, you want to provide that environment where there's enthusiasm, and to Brian and Ewan's point, you know, everybody's coming from abundance and everybody helps each other and they lift each other up and they help each other stay motivated and they have each other's backs when they need help, and you know, they're meeting on a daily basis, they're doing their team huddle every single day, and they're engaged in each other's businesses and in their lives. That's huge, and you cannot underestimate the value of that. We have a couple of questions from folks that I want to make sure we share. I know Tracy Elman had the question of, how do I hire my first assistant? So what would your suggestion be on and any of you guys, what would you suggest on how do I hire my first assistant?
Well, I'd love to jump in since she works for me. I want to make sure this is done right. Hi, Tracy. Thank you for joining and watching. The very first thing to do is, you know, first of all, again, like what Euan says, we have to come from a place of abundance. So you have to firmly believe and take a leap of blind faith that with the assistant, you will for sure absolutely have the time to do what's necessary to be successful in this business. And you have to understand that you are powerful enough to guide yourself in the right direction. The biggest fear most agents have is, look, I don't know if I want to hire somebody full time. Maybe I should get a partner. And they do a lot of weird things. But the reality is, if you have somebody taking 6 to 8 hours of work off your plate every day, it's going to happen. So my very first piece of advice would be to really truly understand personality styles. Do a lot of reading on the DISC personality, all personalities in general. Follow our blog posts on Club Wealth and Real Estate Marketing Show, and really read, you know, read up on personality styles, because we cannot have certain personality styles, like a D, for instance, for our assistant. We don't want a driver. We don't want somebody like me, for God's sakes. I was an assistant for 2 weeks and got fired when I was brand new in the business. I mean, there's no way I can organize a file. So you have to have you have to have those personality styles, and I think birds of a feather flock together. So I'm a super high D, super high I. I love fun party people, and that is the last person you want to be your assistant. You have to have somebody, you know, that's super patient, super organized, you know, people that are willing to talk to people and truly care about their job. I mean, it's absolutely mind blowing how I see so many people fail at hiring their first assistant. So I think if you truly understand personality style and you have the leap of blind faith that you're going to be able to do producing and make sure they're doing the right job. So I would write a checklist of 40 things that you think that person can do to help you to be more productive, whether it's make flyers, upload to Zillow, Trulio, Julio, all the crazy things that we have to do during the day, and ask yourself, if you can pay somebody $15 an hour to do that, should you be? Of course not. And then put that on the list. And then when you actually have that list, you can discuss that with that person and say, is this something you can picture yourself doing? If not, do you think you can adapt to this type of stuff? Because that's ultimately important, that you cannot do what they're going to be doing. You spend a very brief amount of time training them, tell them they're going to be a self-starter and they need to watch, learn, and listen to other people and where you direct them. And I think that's how you initially hire your first assistant. And I don't think that first person should be a buyer's agent. I think that should be your personal assistant / admin to pick up your pieces.
Yeah.
And Mike, you hit the nail on the head about the leap of faith. You know, when I hired my first assistant, I was 21 years old. I had no idea how I was going to pay her. I was scared to death. All I knew was I was overwhelmed. I was freaked out. And I'm thinking about one of our clients. He's actually one of our coaches right now, you know, who went through this recently. And it's very common to be scared and afraid about hiring that first assistant. What you have to understand is when you hire that first assistant, it's not that they're taking money away from you. It's not that you're now losing money that you had coming in. You're expanding your bandwidth in a massive way. And now, instead of you doing things that you hate doing anyway, I mean, let's face it, if you're a great real estate agent, you probably don't enjoy the paperwork and you probably don't enjoy the data entry and all that other stuff that you can have an assistant do for, like Mike said, for $10, $15, you know, $18 an hour. And all of a sudden now you can focus on the three things that every agent has to spend most of their time doing, which is lead generation, lead follow-up, and lead conversion. Those are really the only three things you should be doing in your business anyway. So if you could focus 90% of your time on that instead of 10% of your time, imagine how much more business you'll be doing. I'll tell you, when I hired my first assistant, it was actually Tara, who I ended up marrying 4 years later, and that's when I went to work for her. But that's a whole other story. But I remember when I hired her, the biggest challenge I had was, besides not knowing how to pay her, I didn't know what she was going to do. I started getting her going on stuff. All of a sudden, she took it over. She took responsibility to really dial in her job description, took all this stuff off my plate, and my income went through the roof. It doubled almost instantly. So, you know, don't be afraid.
Because she knew she was going to take half of it someday. She ain't stupid. You know, here, I'll give you a really good test. Hold on. Hey, Jamise, Jolina, come here.
Watch this. Dude, they're going to love you for this. You're in so much trouble.
Come here. But this is the reality.
They're running the other way. They're like, nope, I'm going back door. I think come Jolina here. Just headed for the back door. Go ahead, Mike. We lost you there. Mike, we lost you, bro. Nope. Bjorkman, you've got yourself muted. Hey, don't worry. Mr. Technology over there is learning how to use the mute button.
So one of the things that we learned today, it's very important to understand your technology as a real estate agent.
Yeah, you're out, Mike. We got nothing from Bjorkman. Okay. So while we're waiting for Mike to figure out his technology, let's take another step forward. I want to go back to another suggestion that our good friend Mr. Doug Holliday had for Euan Graham. So Doug, thank you for your comment in the Facebook group. And by the way, those of you that are commenting and posting in the Facebook group and on our Club Wealth page, remember every one of you that comments today is going to get an entry into the Hawaiian vacation giveaway drawing. So make sure that you get your questions for us in there. But Doug Holliday said, Euan, I think that in your situation, coming from such an awesome and unique country, that you should incorporate interactive contests into your posts. For example, give viewers a simple Gaelic phrase and award a prize for the first person who can translate it. So I know Doug is always teasing
those phrases. I need to tell you that Doug and I now correspond through Gaelic on our emails. It's just in Scotland's old tongue. That's how we correspond. There's no English to it. It's all Gaelic. So he must know something that I don't.
I love it. And by the way, another question we've got, Kathleen Beasley was asking a little bit earlier. She says, hey, Euan, as an Irish woman, brand myself? And I told her I thought you would just tell her to brand herself as a Scot instead of an Irish woman. But you tell us. How should she, as an Irish woman, brand herself? She's okay, not going to
work. There's a holiday we have in America that is celebrated a little, you know, too indulgently sometimes, called St. Patrick's Day. And people are always asking me how I celebrate St. Patrick's Day, and I say, I don't. And they're like, what do you mean? I said, it's Irish. I'm from Scotland. Like, we have our own day. It's called St. Andrew's Day, but none of you guys have ever heard about it because Irish got ahead of us and exploited it. So I think, you know, I honestly need to do better about my brand and with the Kilt and everything, because I don't exploit it enough, and I definitely need to do it more. But, you know, I wear my Kilt to some closings, and I need to do that more often. But I think just be genuine to who you are and what the Irish stand for. Obviously, you know, you're just a little below us Scottish people, so that's fine. But I think the thing that we have is that in the United States, everybody's from Scotland or everybody's from Ireland, and you know, everybody comes up to me and says, yeah, my family are from Scotland and we have a castle, and they tell me the name of the castle, and I tell them, oh yeah, I know exactly where it is. It's usually just a pile of rocks that they think is this, you know, famous castle from Braveheart or something like that. But you know, it's a conversation. It's when people hear my accent, I'm lucky because obviously it's different, and they want to know more. My wife grew up in a small town of 800 people, and they all drive these gigantic pickup trucks, wear cowboy hats, belt buckles are like this size. Arrived there, and they had never met anybody from Scotland. But the thing about American people is, and I believe this with all my heart, the majority take interest in people. They like to visit, they like to sit down, they like to break bread, and they like to ask questions. And like, you know, it was a dream going back to her hometown, because everybody wanted to ask me about Scotland and they were fascinated. And that's a life lesson in any circumstance, but it's a real estate lesson as well. If you're not willing to take the time and ask questions and listen and break bread with people, you're not gonna build deep relationships that are gonna serve you for years down the line.
Yeah. You know, I completely agree. And you guys, we talk about the relationships almost in a cliche way, but the reality is it's really true. You know, stop trying to build more transactions and start trying to build more relationships, and you'll see your business go a lot further. So here's the thing. We're out of time. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to go back through like we always do on all our Club Wealth TV episodes. And by the way, shout out to Carol Hershey. I love your comments. She says, I love watching Club Wealth TV. Thank you, Carol. We love having you watch Club Wealth TV. You're the reason why we're here. Thank you for that. So here's what we're going to do. Rapid fire. We're going to go back through. I'm going to start with Brian. Then we're going to go to Mike. Then we're going to finish up with Euan and then myself. And we're going to just do rapid fire, 30 seconds or less. Biggest takeaway from today's Club Wealth TV episode. Brian Curtis.
Biggest takeaway for me, without a doubt, is abundance, abundance, abundance. I heard, I don't even know how many times that was said on this call today, but somebody was trying to tell me to be abundant today, and I appreciate that coming from you, Euan. And I'll say one other thing. It sounds like, you know, you're not a guy who gets up at 10 o'clock in the morning and expects to be done with work at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I appreciate how hard you work, and hard work definitely makes you luckier every day. So thanks so much for being on. Appreciate you.
Love it. Mike Bjorkman. And Mike is still muted. Mike, you're talking just like your wife wants you to, with no volume. Still can't hear him. Okay, so we're going to go right to Euan Graham. And we're going to send a 14-year-old to your office here soon, Mike, to help you with your technology there. So, Euan Graham, you're up, brother.
I'm going to drop a bomb. I'm not really from Scotland. I'm from South Dakota. So the cat's out the bag. No, I think the one thing for me, Michael, and you know this about me, and I mentioned it on the call, is this to everybody that's listening, anybody that watches this, just wake up in the morning and just count your blessings. Think about how lucky you are. Like, I'm from Scotland. It's a progressive country. It's developed. But we do not have the opportunities that we do here. And I'm like a kid in a candy store in this country, because it's set up to be an entrepreneur. It's set up to take the opportunity. And if you wake up with the right mindset and the positive approach and surround yourself with the right people, not energy suckers, you will have success. And people will gravitate towards that. So, you know, wake up in the morning with a smile on your face and go and crush it. That's what I say.
I love it. I love it. All of these takeaways have been great. I'm going to share mine. And it's hard to pick one, so I'm just going to do video. And the big takeaway for me is how easy it is to share your real self on video. You know, you really get a chance to be yourself. People get to know, like, and trust you. So if you're not doing video right now, get out there and do video. You don't worry about getting fancy equipment. Just use what you got. Use your iPhone or your Android if that's all you got. Use your Surface Pro. Whatever you've got, just use it and just be yourself. Come up with some great content. And if you don't feel like you have great content, then just talk about what's going on in your area. Talk about something, a question that people have that they've asked you before. Or ask your Club Wealth coach, or even post in Club Wealth, hey, what questions can I answer on video? Or what kinds of things should I record on video? But at the end of the day, you got to get on video. So Euan Graham, Mike Bjorkman, Brian Curtis, thank you all so much for taking your time today. I know that people really appreciate it. We're getting a lot of comments about how people really do appreciate all of these Club Wealth TV episodes and what you guys bring to the table. And so, in fact, I've got Misty Brunton is saying, hey, I love you, Euan. I want to be you when I grow up. I love it. This is awesome. You guys, thank you again so much. This has been another Club Wealth TV episode. If you haven't done so already, jump on our website. Go to clubwealth.com and check out the blog. Click on our blog, and you can see past episodes of Club Wealth TV. You can also see all kinds of other great blog posts there. But definitely go check out the website, clubwealth.com. Again, my name is Michael Hellickson. On behalf of everybody on the call, thank you again for being here, and remember, you are world class. Oh, there's the kilt. Look out. There is the kilt right there. I love it. All right, guys, go have a world class day. We'll talk to y'all later. Take care.